Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today's video is sponsored by HarperCollins Publishers India because today we are celebrating the release of 17 Church Row by James Carroll. So this is a book that I read for the prompt of hashtag smash the TBR 2020 readathon. The prompt for this book was a book which is 400 pages or more, and this book is precisely I think 405. Yeah, it's 405 pages. So this book is a thriller which is set in England, London. So this book deals with a family, the Rhodes family, consisting of Ethan Rhodes, Nikki Rhodes, and their twins, Grace and Bella. Grace dies in a devastating accident, and that leaves Bella mute forever for her life. So well, Nikki also suffers from anxiety disorder and panic attacks, and they decide eventually to shift to this amazing AI virtually assisted amazingly smart home. So this is a very coming of age novel. So when they shift there, this this house is designed by a very famous architect called Catriona Fisher. So since Ethan Rhodes is RJ in radio, he is like a multimillionaire and stuff like that. So here he can afford this house, and Catriona Fisher in one of the statements, she says that the houses that she visions should be like poor people should look up to it, I cannot afford it, but it's so beautiful. Had I been rich, I could have afforded it, and rich people should be catfighting about it. So that is such a kind of a house that she had built. So when they shift here, strange things start to happen. For example, the housekeeper Sophia, who was very dear to them and was like a mother and a grandmother to them, dies, and eventually Bella gets kidnapped. And there are a lot of things that happen in the book which is really, really good. So first, it's 405 pages, approximately 203 pages. I found it in a very subtle way, nothing great was happening in the book. But suddenly from the 204th page, like just halfway middle, the book changed its pace like anything, and there a lot of things started happening. So eventually when I finished the book, I realized that the first part was not so great, and I think that was intentionally done by the writer because he wanted the book to be slow in the start so that the twists start coming and you really don't get time to digest it, that so many things start happening. This book truly shows how intelligence, artificial intelligence and stuff can be really intimidating. So this book is really, really, really good. I really liked this book, and I wish I could give 5 stars on Amazon because this book is amazing. But if you're a person who does not like computers and stuff, I don't know how much will you enjoy it, but I really, really enjoyed the book. Even if I'm like, I don't enjoy computer a lot, but it's a super book, and I really think you should give this coming of age novel a try. So the next book that I'm going to talk to you about fulfills the prompt, a book which I bought recently. So well, when I started this book was the latest book that I had bought, so I picked this book up, and it's Birthday by Meredith Russo, a love story 18 years in the making. Now this book is a book on the LGBTQIA community, and this deals with transgender issues. So it has two characters, Eric and Morgan. Eric and Morgan were born on the same day in the same hospital in the same place, and their parents have been friends forever, and they have been friends forever. So they don't celebrate a birthday apart from each other, there was one exception when they were 8 years old and one of them was suffering from chickenpox, but apart from that they are always together. But eventually Morgan on his 13th birthday starts developing feelings for Eric, and he realizes that he does not want to stay a boy because he does not have any feelings which a boy has, and he wants to eventually undergo a gender change. And since Morgan's mother had died that same year, or the last year I think, from cancer, he was going through a number of trauma, which is shown in the book. So well, this and this book actually deals with how he overcomes and overcomes this, and how Eric like eventually supports him, and also Morgan's father, who isn't supportive as much because he always tells his son to be in the football team where he's the coach and be like guys and stuff. And here you can actually understand the plight of transgenders, where people judge them so much because they have different they have identity issues, they have different terms with their lives than what mainstream people, like according to the society, have, and trigger warnings for suicide, suicidal thoughts and depression, because this book is very intense. Like, this book was amazingly intense, but I sincerely think that this book could have been a lot shorter than what it is, though the book is I think only 300 something pages. It's like, yeah, it's exactly 300 pages, but I sincerely think the book could have been like 200 and 210 maximum. I think Meredith Russo could have done a better job in making the book a lot more concise than what it already is. But I gave it a 2-star on like Flipkart, like because I bought it from Flipkart, and that the only reason I gave it a 2-star is because though the premise was so good, the execution was also so good, the trigger warnings were not there, and I was really looking for a light read, but this was so intense, and there were things that were like typically unnecessary. So that was the only reason I gave it a 2-star. Otherwise, I would have at least given it as a 3.5. So there's that about my views. But I highly recommend this book for the LGBTQIA community books if you actually want to read one. And these frayed edges are really, really pretty. So the next book that I would like to talk to you about is a book which is like really famous and also has a movie. And I read this book for the prompt, a book about Holocaust. So the next book is a classic, and that is The Boy in the Striped Pajamas by John Boyne. So well, people who don't know this, this is also my new favorite in middle grade. So this is a book where like there are two boys named Samuel and Bruno. Bruno is the son of the Nazi commander, and they shift from Berlin to Auschwitz. He cannot pronounce Auschwitz, so he calls it Outwith, and he's a kind of an explorer. And when he goes there, he finds that there are no friends of, like there are no guys to make friends with of his age. So he eventually sees that there is a huge plot outside his home, which is like barred with fences, and there are people, a lot of people there, a lot of guys of his own age, and he really wants to make friends with them, but he notices that they all wear the same uniform, that is striped pajamas. So eventually one day he goes for exploring and finds like this guy called Samuel, and they become friends. Samuel is a Jew, obviously from Poland. I think in Krakow his father is a watchmaker, and then now he ended up in Auschwitz in the Holocaust camp. So eventually they become friends with each other, but as you can, I don't know whether you can predict, this book does not end on a very good note. It's a very sad ending, so that's one is really spoilery. But I loved the book, the font was so big, the chapters were awesome, and the book was so engaging. I cried after I read the book because it was amazing. And the best thing about the book that I liked is after you read it, there is interview with the author, which I really loved reading. And there are also questions like what are the names of Bruno's three best friends for life, there are quizzes for you to solve. So eventually when you read the book and you solve the quiz, I felt really wholesome. So this is a book that I chose for a book about Holocaust. The next book that I'm going to talk to you about is a book which is blue in color. So I picked up The Clothing of Books by Jhumpa Lahiri. This is my first book of Jhumpa Lahiri. I even don't have any other one of hers. But since I read that she's an awesome writer, so I picked this book up. This is a non-fiction book, and it basically deals with her perceptions of dust jackets of books. So people who don't know, hardcovers have dust jackets on them. And she basically talks here about her experiences and about her writing, about people choosing dust jackets for her, and the illustrations and how she feels about her books after they are published. So it was a really, really good treat, because I don't usually enjoy nonfiction, but this was such a light read, and you can see it's very, very thin. Like, it's about like 50, 60 pages. I clearly don't remember. I think it's 70. Yeah, it's 71 pages. So not very close, but yeah, 71 pages. So I finished it one go, but I really, really enjoyed the book. It was so perceptive, and there were so many interpretations of what she was saying that I loved it. I just loved it. The next book that I'm going to talk to you about is a book which is I chose this book for contemporary book, the prompt contemporary book. So this book was suggested to me by my friend Ipshita. I read this book in January during New Year. But I also talked to you about the book haul when this was in book haul. So I'm going to talk to you in detail in this one. So it is An Abundance of Catherines by John Green. So here in this book, there's this guy called Colleen Singleton who is dumped by his girlfriend Catherine. He has had 19 girlfriends, and all of them were named Catherine with this same spelling. So he is this person who's supposed to be a prodigy, and he's amazing in studies and stuff. So in this book, he eventually goes out on a road trip with his friend Hassan, because he had this breakup with his eventual 19th Catherine, who he thought was the one. And he goes to this place. I clearly don't remember. I think he goes to Tennessee. Yeah, he goes to Tennessee, and he finds this girl called what was the name? I think Lydia. Yeah, her name was Lydia. So he finds this girl. So eventually he understands that he does not have to date a girl called Catherine. Actually, this was a really messed up book for me, because I really like John Green's writing, but I can't even explain the premise properly, because this book is so messed up. Like, there are graphs and stuff in the book, like where Colin tries to explain people as to what he feels about Catherine. There are footnotes about each and everything that he says, and there are mathematical equations, which I usually like in books, because obviously I had one. So yeah, you can see here that there's an inverted hyperbola here and stuff. So inverted parabola, I'm sorry. So there are things like that in the book, but I did not like this book like at all. Like, this was so messed up for me that I just hated the book. I usually enjoy John Green's writing because he's one of my favorite authors, but I really do not enjoy this book so much. Like, after everything that happened in the book, this book concentrated on Oblivion. I was like, how is even Oblivion related to anything that was there in the start? So I was so very confused when I read, eventually read the book. I really want to give it another try, because I really enjoy John Green's writing, and I did not enjoy this. And this was a recommendation from a friend who's really, really sweet. So I was like, oh my God, I did not like it. I was devastated after I read the book. I was like, I did not like it? Really? So this was like that thing. Like, I also enjoyed the cover of the book and everything, but this book was a real mess up for me. But I really do want to give it another try, another chance, and I think I'll do it like really, really soon during the summers when I actually feel like reading contemporary again. The next book that I'm going to pick up is We Are Okay by Nina Lacour. Now, this book is basically, I picked this book up for a book which is black in color. Now, you'll tell me this is not black in color, but it has multiple patches in black. So I picked this book up for a book which is black in color, and it was in my TBR. So I was like, why not? So here, this book, in this book, Nina Lacour talks about there are two girls called Mehrin and Mabel. Mehrin lived with her grandfather, and after he dies, she was an orphan who lived with her grandfather. She had never known his father, and her mother died when she was a kid. So she was basically raised by him, and when he dies, she's devastated. And Mabel was her high school girlfriend, and she just leaves everyone and then like comes to New York and gets enrolled in this college. So eventually, this is a Christmassy book, so in one Christmas, then the following year, Mabel contacts her. After contacting her for months, Mehrin replies, and Mabel thinks that it's high time she should come and meet her. So Mabel travels all the way and comes to New York, and like meets Marin at the like hostel where she is living, and she's all alone, and only the housekeeper is there to look after her because everybody has gone back home. And there are a lot of questions which are unanswered that Marin has to, you know, find answers for. There are so many things that she has to face. Well, basically, there is an LGBTQIA relationship which you can evidently understand, and Mabel is also a bisexual, so that is another trope for people who want to read more about it. So if I basically like this book, but this book was also the same like 17 Totoro. This was like this was like 280 pages or something, right? Yeah, it was 234, but exactly on like 114, 115th page, I was like, it was like really slow. And then everything started changing and developing so fast, I started falling for the book. So that was the main reason I gave it a 3 stars. There's a huge trigger warning for depression, because there's a lot of depressed and anxiety thoughts that are in the book. So if you want to read this for that trope too, it will be amazing. I really enjoyed the book, but I think Nina Lacour could have done a better job at the first half of the book, because I understand that Marin has to face her fears and she cannot run away throughout like her entire life, but that could have been a lot shorter version. I think this book could have been completed in like 170 pages or something. So there's that, but I gave it an average rating of 3 stars on Goodreads because that's what I felt about it. So the final book that I'm going to talk to you guys about in this video is a book that was given to me by my best friend on my birthday, and this was like a really anticipated read for me, and so. And me and my TBR. So this book got released last year, but I was so anticipating to read this, and it is The Chalkman by CJ Tudor. I picked this book up for the trope, a book which is mystery. So this book follows like a couple of friends who discover a dead body. And that dead body is of a girl who is chopped into pieces. So, and there are like chalkmen, like there are like men who like these type of men who are drawn with chalks all over the town. It's like it's set in a small out of reach town in England. So there's that. This has a typical IT feeling to it. So when I was reading it, I was getting a lot of IT vibes. So that is what. So basically this book is set in two timelines. One is in 1986 and one is in 2016. So there's that. So basically this book deals with who is this the chalkman, who is drawing those chalkmen on the roads and everywhere, and who is the person who murdered that like girl so badly, like who is the person who mutilated her body and cut her with axe into pieces. There are so many things that go on in this book that I love this book entirely. There were times when I was getting pissed off, but eventually I love this book so much. I gave it a solid 4 stars, a rating on Goodreads, because I love this book so much. I expected a lot more from the ending though, because I felt the ending was a little rushed, maybe because the author felt she's dragging it too much. But I really enjoyed the book, because this book is, I think, the debut book of CJ Tudor. I'm not sure, or is the second book, but her writing is so damn mature. I was so astounded by her writing. It is just wonderful. The characterization is so strong, and when you read it, you will get the typical IT vibes. So when I read this, I was like, wow, I really need to read all of her books. And another of her book is coming out this year, or has already come out, I'm not sure. It's called The Other People. I'm also excited for that. And I have another book of hers called The Taking of Annie Thorne, which I have in my TBR. Actually, I had it for the month of February, but I did not read it, so I think I'll read it in the month of March. yes, I will read in the month of March. Or if I don't read in the month of March, that's my dog shouting. So if I don't eventually read in the month of March, I'll read it in Halloween. I was really happy with this book and I highly, highly recommend it. I will link all the links of the book in the description down below for you guys to check out and buy if you guys really want to. Because all of these books were really awesome in their own ways. Even the ones which I did not like and have rated low, it's because the times were wrong or the book wasn't actually for me. But that does not mean that you cannot like these books and love these books in your own manner. And if any of you have already read this book and are in love with these books, the ones which I did not like, I am perfectly fine with your opinion. It just doesn't, I'm sorry if I hurt you, but it just wasn't for me at that time. Or maybe there was something wrong, maybe the environment in which I was reading was wrong, but the books are really special in their own way, and I highly recommend you guys you guys can check it out for yourselves by reading all the other reviews too, how you guys feel about it. So anyway, thank you so much for watching. Have a great day ahead. Mwah. And do not forget to give me a thumbs up on my video. Do not forget to comment, like, share and subscribe. And do not forget to press on the bell icon so that whenever I upload a video, you come to know about it. Down in the description, I've also attached my Instagram, Facebook, blog, Goodreads and Twitter accounts. Do not forget to give a follow up. Bye-bye. Have a great day ahead. Mwah.